Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Speak Dog, Mastering the Art of Dog-Human Communication by Stanley Coren, PhD. Narrated by Rudy Sanda. Preface. Man has great power of speech, but the greater part thereof is empty and deceitful. The animals have little, but that little is useful and true. And better is a small and certain thing than a great falsehood. Leonardo da Vinci, Notebook, circa 1500. There is a traditional story which tells us that King Solomon had a silver ring that bore his seal and the true name of God. This ring gave him the ability to understand and to speak with animals. When Solomon died, that ring was hidden in a great house with many doors. When I was young, I wished that I had a ring so that I could speak with my dogs. While I knew that this was just a folk tale, as an adult, I became more inclined to believe that wise King Solomon could speak with animals, even without the magic ring the legend tells of, because you and I can also learn to do this. The magic in Solomon's ring is an understanding of how animals communicate, and it is hidden in science, which is the house of many doors. The knowledge that is needed is similar to the knowledge you need to speak any language. To speak to a dog, you must first learn the vocabulary, specifically, what constitutes the words in his canine language. You must also learn the grammar of the language, namely, how to string those words together and combine them so that you can form sentences that can be used to send and receive meaningful messages. This book is about dog communication, how they speak to each other, how they understand messages that humans send to them, and how humans can translate the ideas the dog is trying to transmit. Understanding how dogs communicate allows a much greater ability to know what they are feeling, what they are thinking, and what their intentions are. It also provides more ways to tell them what you want them to do and to control their behavior. This doesn't mean that one can have profound conversations with dogs about natural history, moral philosophy, or even the latest Hollywood films. On the other hand, I find that my conversations with dogs are often richer and more complex than those I have with my 2- and 3-year-old grandchildren, and often they deal with very similar topics. Knowing canine language also prevents some common misunderstandings between human beings and canines. During our language lessons, we will learn about some remarkable dogs and just how clever some everyday canines can be. We will also find out how humans have affected the linguistic ability of dogs during the long history of the domestication of our first animal companions. Some of my scientific colleagues may object to the use of the word language when I speak about the communication ability of dogs. It has long been believed that language is an ability confined to humans. It will become clear, however, that there is a great deal of similarity in the communication patterns of humans and dogs. As a psychologist, I'm perfectly happy drawing conclusions about human learning based upon data obtained from rats or monkeys. And the same is true of most researchers. This would be clear folly if one believed that human learning is radically different in kind from that found in other animals. Therefore, I'm often surprised that, when the question turns to language and communication, some behaviorists lose their belief in the continuity of abilities across species, and insist that there is a radical difference separating human language from animal communication. Whether true language is unique to humans is an interesting question with a long and fascinating history that will unfold during our attempt to learn how to understand and speak the language of dogs. 1. Conversations with canines. The argument was very sound, and coming from a master's mouth would have been lauded for its truth. But since the author was a hound, its merit went unrecognized. Jean de La Fontaine, 1621-1695. The Farmer, the Dog, and the Fox. It is probably the case that virtually every human being has, at one time or another, wanted to be Dr. Doolittle, or to own King Solomon's ring, so that he or she could understand and talk with animals. For me, the animals that I most wanted to speak to were dogs. I remember one Sunday evening, I was sitting on the living room floor in front of the big family radio with my beagle, Skippy. I was leaning against the side of an overstuffed chair waiting for a regularly scheduled radio show featuring my favorite movie star. The theme music started. I think it was actually the folk tune Greensleeves. And then a few moments later, I could hear her voice. She was barking in the distance and coming closer every second. Long before our current wave of canine movie stars such as Benji and Beethoven, and their television counterparts, Eddie, Wishbone, and the Littlest Hobo, there was Lassie. She was much more than a dog. She was a friend and devoted companion. She was a guardian of the right, a courageous protector, and a fearless fighter. The dog that may have done the most to shape the popular conception of dogs and their intelligence was a character born in a short story published in the Saturday Evening Post by Eric Knight in 1938. The story was so well received that Knight later expanded it into a best-selling book in 1940, and in 1943, it was translated into a heartwarming tear-jerker of a movie called Lassie, Come Home. It was filmed in rich colors and set in Britain, where Lassie's poor family is forced by their financial troubles to sell their faithful collie to a wealthy dog fancier, whose daughter is played by a very young Elizabeth Taylor. Lassie escapes from the Duke of Rudling's harsh kennel keeper and manages to work her way from Scotland to England to get home to her young master, who is played by Roddy McDowall. The role of Lassie was not portrayed by a lovely female dog at all, but by a male dog named Pal. In fact, all of the Lassies ever since have been female impersonators. Male collies were preferred to play the part, since they are larger and less timid than female collies. More important, when an unspayed female dog goes into heat, which they do twice a year, she often loses much of her coat. It would be very distressing to movie watchers, and it would be a film editor's nightmare to have the fullness of Lassie's coat vary from one scene to another. Gender issues aside, Lassie had a huge impact on our concept of how dogs think and act. This was partly due to the volume of material about her that we were exposed to. So far, there have been 10 feature films showing her exploits. In these, Lassie managed to upstage some of the greatest stars in Hollywood, including James Stewart, Helen Slater, Nigel Bruce, Elsa Lanchester, Frederick Forrest, Mickey Rooney, and many others. There was also a TV show which ran from 1954 through to 1991, with a few interruptions, using 6 different settings and rotations of cast. At times, Lassie's families included such familiar actors as Cloris Leachman and June Lockhart. Many of these episodes are still appearing on television in syndicated reruns today. There was even a Lassie cartoon series, Lassie's Rescue Rangers, that played on Saturday morning TV for the kids. Perhaps Lassie's most unusual starring role was in a radio series, which ran from 1947 through 1950, and I was one of her young fans. I'll bet that given the media mentality of today, producers of a radio series involving a dog might argue that it was necessary to give Lassie a human voice, so that we could hear her thoughts and know what she wanted to say. It would be a soft female voice, of indeterminate age, perhaps with a slight Scottish accent to remind us of her origin. These early radio episodes, however, were true to the character of Lassie on the screen. She never spoke human language, she barked. It is interesting to note that Pal actually did the barking on the radio show. However, the whining, panting, snarling, and growling were all convincingly done by human actors. One part of the magic of the show was that Lassie did not have to speak in English, Spanish, German, French, or any other human tongue. Her family and everybody who heard her understood her completely. An episode might typically go like this. Lassie runs out into the field, barking and whimpering frantically. Her young master asks, "What's wrong, girl?" And Lassie barks. "There's something wrong with Mom," he interprets, and Lassie barks and whimpers. "Oh no, she's hurt herself. Dad told her not to use that machine by herself. You go get Dr. Williams. I saw him stopping by the Johnson place just a little bit down the road. I'll go back to see if I can help." The boy runs across the field toward home. Lassie barks and races off for help. The doctor will, of course, understand every bark and whine and come to the rescue as well. In other episodes and at other times, Lassie's barks tell of bad men coming, of hidden or stolen goods, or alerts her master that someone is either lying or speaking the truth. It seems that Lassie speaks a universal speech. There is one episode with a boy from France who comes to live with his uncle after his family dies tragically. This poor child speaks no English. Fortunately, he doesn't have to. Lassie speaks the universal language of dogs. Let's call it doggish. He, of course, understands it immediately, since apparently all French dogs use the same language. Because of this, Lassie is able to tell him, with more barks, whimpers, whines, and an occasional muted growl, that he has come to a place where people want to be his friends, although there is one bad boy he should watch out for. Lassie comforts him, integrates him into the community, settles some misunderstandings between him and the local children, and then teaches him his first few words of English, which are, of course, "Lassie, you are a good dog." I really felt jealous of Lassie's family and neighbors. They could all understand the language of dogs, and they knew how to make their own dog understand exactly what they were saying as well. I fondled Skippy's long, leathery ears and wondered why I was so linguistically inept. It's not that I couldn't understand anything that Skippy was trying to tell me. When his tail wagged, I knew that he was happy. When his tail was tucked under his belly, I knew that he was feeling poorly. When he barked, I knew that someone was coming, or that he wanted to eat, or that he wanted to play, or that he was excited. Well, he barked a lot. When he bayed, that little yodeling sound that beagles make, I knew that he was happily tracking something. The linguistic failings were not Skippy's. They were mine. Sometimes my dog would be incredibly innovative in telling me what he wanted. There was the day he deliberately pushed his water dish across the kitchen floor until it banged against my shoe, just to tell me that he was thirsty and the bowl was empty. Still, most of the time I just couldn't understand what he was saying, and our lack of communication made me very sad. Now, after many years of research and study, I think I am beginning to understand the language of my canine friends. As a psychologist, I have also come to realize how an understanding of dog communication can affect human-dog relationships. In humans, language often appears to be the single most important element in determining successful social relationships and general adjustment. When you look at the research on the relationship between children with disabilities and their families, you find that love and affection can be fostered and maintained even though the child suffers from massive problems, as long as the child can speak and understand language at a useful level. The families of children who have many fewer difficulties but whose language ability is impaired report more severe social and adjustment problems, and seem to feel less affection and more frustration with the child. Similarly, several studies have shown that the single most important factor in determining whether an immigrant or refugee will integrate well into their new society is the speed and proficiency with which they learn the language of their new country. In much the same way, a human's ability to understand the language of the dog can determine how well the dog is accepted into the family. Misreading a dog's emotional state can be distressing for its human family, and can even be fatal for the dog. Consider the case of Finnegan, a beautiful Irish setter from a kennel run by a woman named Melanie. I knew Melanie as a careful breeder, whose conscientiousness had allowed her to create a line of dogs that were not only physically handsome, but also warm, playful, and tolerant. With that in mind, you can imagine Melanie's distress when she received a phone call from the family that had bought Finnegan. They complained that he was too aggressive. They said he was leaping and snarling at visitors and other dogs. When these problems arose, the family had called in a trainer, but he had found the dog difficult to handle and failed to eliminate these aggressive displays. In the end, he had recommended that the dog be euthanized. The family didn't want to do this, but felt they couldn't keep him under the circumstances. Melanie offered a refund of the purchase price and asked that the dog be sent back to her. Then she called me up. "I've never really had to deal with an aggressive dog before," she said. "I was wondering if you could be with me when I go to pick him up, just in case there's something I can't handle." I couldn't imagine one of her dogs being aggressive, but the worry in her voice was such that I agreed. I was there to help pick Finnegan up. I had brought with me the usual accoutrement for dealing with virtually any type of aggressive dog. There were a couple of strong leashes, a slip collar, a head halter, a muzzle, and even a large heavy blanket in case the dog had to be physically restrained by wrapping him so that some of this control equipment could be applied. In addition, I brought a pair of heavy leather gloves, which have literally saved my skin a few times. When the truck carrying Finnegan arrived, I bent down to look into the front of his tan plastic carrying kennel. No snarls, no growls, just an excited whimper. Still, caution seemed like the best plan, so we opened the door slowly. Out leapt this happy red dog, who looked around, trying to discern where he was. Then, in a response that was clearly triggered by the unfamiliar surroundings of the loading dock, he showed every tooth in that large mouth of his. My response was involuntary, but I think that I upset Melanie when I began to laugh. I realized that to a person who doesn't understand the language of dogs, this flash of 42 long white teeth could easily have been interpreted as an aggressive display. However, there are different ways that a dog can show its teeth. And the expression Finnegan was wearing was actually a submissive and pacifying grin. This expression did not mean, "back off or I'll bite," but rather, "it's okay. I'm not a threat. I understand that you're the boss around here." The young setter's bounciness did cause him to leap at people and other dogs, but this leaping was done as part of a greeting. He simply wanted to touch noses with those tall, two-footed dogs that we call humans, and the only way to reach their nose was to jump up. To ensure that this would not be viewed as a threat, he did it with a submissive grimace. The more he was corrected by the family and trainers for his aggression, the more submissive he became. The more submissive he was feeling, the wider he smiled, reasoning that they had simply missed his signal and he truly wanted to pacify the situation. Of course, the wider he smiled, the more teeth he showed. Finnegan's first family simply didn't understand what the dog was trying to say. Had they followed the advice they were given, they might have put this handsome red dog into an early grave. Finnegan now lives happily with a new family. Melanie tells me that he still smiles and jumps a bit, but she has explained what this means to his new masters. Because they understand his message, they know that he is safe to love. Unfortunately, mistranslation of the signals that a dog is giving is quite common and can lead to serious problems and bad feelings. A woman named Eleanor came to me with a problem. It involved Wheedles, a blonde American Cocker Spaniel, who, according to her mistress, was driving my husband crazy. She simply refuses to be housebroken and is now making puddles simply out of spite. Stephen, her husband, says if we can't solve this problem quickly, we'll have to get rid of her. The period of time while a puppy is learning to be clean in the house is often stressful. It is usually solved within a few weeks, however, if care is taken to regulate the dog's food and water intake, and the owner is alert to the times when the dog should be taken out to empty its bladder and bowels. In this case, Wheedles was nearly 7 months old, which seemed a bit old not to be housebroken. So I asked what they had done to train her. Stephen likes things in the house to be neat and clean, so it was important that we housebreak Wheedles early. I read one of the books on puppies and followed its advice, and we got her to make her stool outside. But we still occasionally had wet accidents. Stephen said I was being too easy on Wheedles, and he would solve the problem. When he found a place where she'd wet the floor, he dragged her over and rubbed her nose in it. Then he yelled at her and gave her a slap on the rear when he put her outside. Stephen went away on a sales trip and was gone for nearly 4 weeks. During that time, Wheedles was fine. Maybe there were one or two accidents, but that was all. And I just cleaned it up and put her out in the yard without a whole lot of fuss. The last 2 weeks, things were absolutely clean. Then, just a few days ago, Stephen came back and everything fell apart. You wouldn't believe what this dog did. The moment Stephen walked into the house, she peed on the floor right in front of him. He got so angry, I thought he was really going to hurt her. Wheedles just seems to want to annoy him. Whenever Stephen walks into the room, she crouches way down low and makes a puddle in front of him just for spite. Yesterday was the last straw. Stephen walked into the room and Wheedles rolled on her back, like dogs sometimes do for a belly rub. When he bent over her, she tried to pee right into his face. That's why I'm here today. My heart went out immediately to poor Wheedles. Dogs do not communicate by using the same signals that humans do. In this case, Wheedles was giving a clear message in the only language that she knew. Unfortunately, there were no translators around, so her plea for understanding was being misread and getting her into trouble. Her problem had nothing to do with housebreaking. From my conversation with Eleanor, I knew that Wheedles was almost completely housebroken by now. The problem had to do with her husband, Stephen. In his early interactions with Wheedles over her urinating on the floor, he was particularly harsh in his corrections. This caused Wheedles to become quite fearful of him. If a dog is experiencing a large amount of social fear, it will try to make itself appear to be as small, insignificant, and non-threatening as possible. Crouching low to the ground or rolling over onto its back are part of this pattern. What Eleanor thought was a spiteful attempt to urinate on her husband's face was simply the release of urine from a dog who was rolling into a very submissive and frightened position. The urine was designed to remind the dominant dog of puppy behaviors. Puppies need to be cleaned of urine and feces when they are small, and the mother usually simply rolls them on their backs to do this. Thus, Weedles was really trying her best to say, "You frighten me, but look, I'm no threat. I'm nothing more significant than a helpless puppy." Once Weedle's message was translated for Eleanor, the situation became much clearer. Now her task was to try to build Weedle's confidence. A larger problem might be trying to get her husband to be gentler and less threatening around the dog. Many common canine messages can be misinterpreted. A woman named Josephine once asked me to help her with a problem she was having with her dog. "Bluto is acting far too affectionately toward me, and it bothers me and upsets my husband. He originally got Bluto as a guard dog, and he doesn't want him acting like a wimp, even around the family," she told me over the phone. Bluto turned out to be a large, dark Rottweiler, who had been named after the big, bad, ugly cartoon character who was always fighting with Popeye the Sailor Man. The name, which had been given by Josephine's husband, Vincent, told me something about the man and his expectations for the dog. Vincent was a forceful trainer, and had often used fairly harsh methods to enforce his will over Bluto. The dog obeyed him, although sometimes with apparent reluctance. According to Josephine, Bluto didn't obey her at all, but did show extreme and persistent signs of affection toward her. When I arrived at their home, Vincent was at work and Josephine brought me into her living room. I sat on a chair and looked across at her, sitting primly near one end of the sofa with Bluto beside her on the floor. Bluto appeared to be around 120 pounds of hard muscle, while Josephine appeared to be around 100 pounds, very slight, and not particularly athletic. As we talked, Bluto placed his paw on her knee, and she immediately responded by stroking his head. After a few moments, Bluto jumped up onto the sofa beside her, and Josephine moved slightly to one side to accommodate his great bulk. He sat there, looking occasionally at me, and then staring at her. When he looked directly into her eyes, she would reach her hand up and lightly stroke the side of his face. Next, Bluto leaned his weight against the small woman. After a few moments, she shifted to the side to be free of the pressure of the heavy dog. He reacted by shifting his position so that he was again sitting beside her, and once more leaning against her. Again, she moved away a few inches, and again the dog moved closer. As we spoke, this spectacle continued until Josephine had been forced all the way to the far end of the sofa. At the point where she could no longer move any farther, she stood up in exasperation and pointed at the dog. "This is exactly what I mean. He's always asking for attention by pawing at me. He's always staring into my eyes and leaning against me to show me how much he loves me. I can't even watch a television show without him pushing me off the sofa unless Vince is here. I don't want to hurt his feelings, but he's a big dog. That kind of continuous affection from such a large animal is annoying and disturbs my husband. Is there some way we could train him to be less dependent and more confident and independent?" Once again, a message had been sent by a dog and misinterpreted by the human receiver. Bluto was not telling Josephine, "I love you, I need you, I'm totally dependent upon your affection," which was the translation she and her husband were giving to these signals. Instead, Bluto was saying, "I am higher status than you are. When the leader of the pack, Vincent, is away, then I'm in charge, and you will give way to me and respond to my needs." The signs of dominance were all quite readable. A dog who puts his paw on a human's knee is often expressing dominance over that human, in the same way that a wolf will put his paw or head over the shoulder of another wolf to demonstrate that he is of higher status. Bluto staring directly into Josephine's eyes is a classic dominance and threat gesture, designed to produce pacifying responses in other pack members. Josephine was accepting his dominance by stroking the side of his face, in the same way that a wolf of lower dominance might lick the face of a higher status dog. Finally, his leaning behavior was designed to make the small woman give way. Pack leaders can occupy any part of the territory they desire and can sit or sleep where they want to. Lower-ranking members of the pack move away to permit this, thus accepting the other animal's dominance. In other words, everything Bluto was saying pointed to, "I'm boss," and everything that Josephine was saying was, "Yes, I humbly accept your authority." Once the message became clear, the solution to the problem could easily be found. In the end, Josephine had to take Bluto to basic dog obedience classes, where he learned to follow her commands. Since she couldn't physically dominate the dog, she used treats to induce him to respond. She also became completely responsible for his feeding at home, and required him to respond to simple commands like sit and stay before he would be fed. In the wild, it is the leader of the pack who eats first and controls the hunt and distribution of food. By controlling food, in the form of meals and treats, and insisting upon Bluto's responding to her commands to get these, Josephine was now using a form of dog communication to tell him, "This two-footed dog is of higher status than you, even if I'm not as large or strong as you are." In the same way that people can learn to interpret the language of dogs, there is no doubt that we humans can communicate with dogs if the person chooses to speak in their canine language. An interesting instance of this was described to me by Dr. Michael Fox, who has made his mark as one of the foremost researchers on dog and wild canine behavior. At that time, Fox was a faculty member in the psychology department of Washington University in St. Louis. He was doing some marvelous work comparing the behavior patterns of various wild canines, such as the wolf, fox, and coyote, with the behavior patterns of domestic dogs. This was the work which eventually convinced scientists that there is a universal core of behaviors common for all canines. To the extent that this is true, we can learn about our pet dog by studying the behaviors of wild wolves. Conversely, we can learn about wolves by the study of a little spaniel who might be nestled at our feet. This is a well-accepted concept today, but at the time it was still controversial. I met Dr. Fox after a lecture he had given. When I introduced myself, I mentioned that I had seen the television documentary he had worked on called The Wolfman. He responded immediately and took the discussion off in an unexpected direction. "Ah, yes. You know, that project taught me that I did know how to communicate with wolves well enough to save myself from harm, but that I didn't know enough about what the wolves were saying to avoid difficulties in the first place." There was a tone of amusement rippling through his mildly English-accented voice. "You see, we'd just introduced some wolves to each other in the research compound, and we were hoping we could photograph their behavior. I believed we had an opportunity to get some good film of their greeting patterns and how they sorted out their dominance relationships. In any event, the oldest male and his mate, both around 4 years old, were down at the end of the research area with the rest of the group. It turns out that the female was in heat and was doing a lot of submissive nudging at the male. With strange wolves around in his territory and a mate in heat, I suppose the male was getting pretty edgy about the whole thing. We'd been concealed behind some bushes, when this pair broke away from the others and came toward the shrubbery where we were hiding. When they passed us, I thought we could get some good pictures of them, so I rushed after them. Suddenly they reversed their direction, and I was caught in the act. Here was this human being rushing directly toward them and staring at them. At the best of times, that kind of activity, running directly forward and direct eye contact, signals a threat, so I immediately stopped moving. I thought that that would be enough to avoid any problem. But I must have still been staring directly at them in what had to be interpreted as a wide-eyed challenge. There were no further words between us. The male simply attacked me. With a camera strapped to each of my wrists, there wasn't a lot that I could do, so I raised my hands in the air and shouted for the handler. In retrospect, this was the wrong thing to do, since the elevated hands looked like another attempt at asserting dominance. Doubtless this was read as equivalent to another animal rearing up to make itself seem larger. The shouting might also be misinterpreted as a bark or growl bark. Meanwhile, the male was biting my hand and arm and back, and the female had joined in and was attacking my legs. It was at that point that I finally had the presence of mind to remember how to tell them that this attack wasn't necessary. I froze in place and huddled down to make myself small, all the while making whines and whimpering sounds like a frightened and submissive wolf cub. Although they immediately broke off the attack, the male came right in front of my face, gazing directly into my eyes and snarling. I responded by averting my eyes and avoiding any eye contact while still continuing to whine. When the pair seemed to have eased off a bit, I tried to back away from them a little, but that only made them attack again. This time, though, the attack was all threats and no actual biting, which meant that the most important part of my message had gotten through. Around that time, the handler arrived, got hold of the male and dragged him away. The female stayed with her eyes staring directly at me, as if waiting for me to make the next move. I didn't. I just stayed there, eyes half closed in submission and whimpering, until they finally got a collar on her and pulled her away. Fortunately, I was wearing some pretty thick clothing, so their teeth didn't break a lot of skin. On the other hand, the pressure and the shaking when they bit me caused a lot of pain and bruising, and also some muscle and tendon damage. He laughed lightly and sipped at his drink. One of the people who was there took some photos of the whole incident. One of those pictures shows a perfect example of a fear grimace. Only it's being displayed by a human psychologist and not a frightened wolf. In this case, an extremely knowledgeable and intelligent human being inadvertently gave the wrong set of signals to a canine, and this produced an attack. Fortunately for him, he knew enough about canine language to be able to convey that it was all a mistake, and that he had no intention of continuing to challenge or suggesting any further threat. This probably saved him from considerable harm. In many respects, our ability to live successfully and happily with any dog may depend upon our competence in reading the dog's language. If a person knows how to speak doggish, then they can interpret what the dog is trying to say and also give unambiguous signals which the dog can translate. Unlike human languages, which have to be learned, much of the dog's language is encoded in its genes. He does have the capacity to learn to understand a lot of human language as well, which will ultimately make communication with people easier. However, before we can discuss speaking with our canine companions, it will be useful to know something about language itself. 2. Evolution and animal language. Before we can speak of translating the language of dogs, we should first answer a critical basic question. Do any animals other than humans have their own languages? Although most scientists will agree that animals can communicate with each other, the problem seems to lie in what we are going to define as language. Many researchers, particularly linguists, will grant that animals can use sounds as part of their communication system. However, they go on to claim that animals don't even have the basic language elements that we can call words. According to their analysis, animals have no ability to name objects in the environment, such as ball or tree, or to express abstract notions, such as love or truth. Noam Chomsky, the well-known linguist from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, has offered a theory that only humans are capable of learning languages because only humans have the brain structures needed. Humans learn vocabulary at a fantastic rate. Between the ages of 2 and 17, the average child will increase its vocabulary at a rate equivalent to learning a new word every 90 minutes of its waking life. At the same time, it will acquire a complex grammar and syntax. What is most amazing is that all of this is learned without the need of formal schooling and instruction. According to Chomsky, this remarkable achievement can only be explained by assuming that all human brains come with a built-in language processing organ. This special organ does not contain a specific language, but rather the blueprint for learning all languages. It also includes the basic structure of what he calls universal grammar. This is what allows children to learn language so quickly. In effect, they already know how languages are structured because their genes have provided the information of what are acceptable or unacceptable language constructions. My difficulty with Chomsky's theory that language is an exclusively human ability comes from an evolutionary viewpoint. Language clearly gives humans a great survival advantage. We can transmit or receive vital information about the state of the world and our local environment using language. We can also communicate information about past events, and even about our predictions of what will happen in the future through the use of language. It makes survival a lot easier when individuals can tell each other where there is food and water, where a lion was last seen lurking about, or warn of the approach of a forest fire. Language can also be used to coordinate social interactions with other members of the group, whether individuals are organizing a hunt, arranging care for their babies, establishing social contact with potential mates, or resolving a difficulty with another individual or band in order to avoid physical conflict. Any animal species that had language would thus have a powerful tool which would make it a more successful beast in this hostile world. Whenever there is some successful evolutionary adaptation or change in an animal, it is almost always preceded by some simpler versions. Consider the marvelous mechanical device that has given human beings the ability to create our technological world, our thumb. It is an opposable thumb, which means that we can touch it to the tips of any of our other fingers. This provides the ability to deftly manipulate small objects and to create and use tools. This special digit first appeared in monkeys as a stubby thing, not really opposable against any fingertips. As the various primates evolved into apes, however, it grew longer, and in some other primates, the thumb can oppose one or even two fingers to some degree. Thus, the human thumb shows evidence of evolving from simpler forms that predated it. Similarly, the spectacular flying ability of birds was preceded by less complex versions of this skill. At an earlier time, there were animals, for example, pterodactyls, which could glide through the air. This gliding was not true flight, but rather a sort of floating through the air with a limited degree of control. The flight ability of birds is simply a more advanced and complex evolution of this simpler ability to soar or glide. What has been added is the ability to take off from any surface and to change altitude at will. Most important and useful abilities show some form of continuous change through the eons of evolution. What Chomsky and others who deny language ability in non-human animals are offering is what biologists call a hopeful monster theory. It is a miraculous accident in which a freak mutation, just by chance, happens to produce a radically better equipped animal. The evolutionary theorists' version of divine intervention. This kind of explanation makes me uncomfortable. Evolution is much like a big highway that species travel down. Changes in direction are fairly gradual, since too sharp a turn will cause the quickly traveling vehicles, or evolving species, to fly off the road into extinction. At the biological level, this idea of a highway shows up in the form of continuous slow change, with a lot of similarity between various animal species, especially at the genetic level. It might be surprising, or even disturbing, for some people to learn that recent findings in modern biochemistry suggest that humans are not so genetically unique as we might have thought. DNA analysis suggests that at the molecular and genetic levels, humans and chimpanzees are at least 98% identical. This degree of similarity is so close that some scientists have proposed it might be possible to perform crossbreeding and make a hybrid species. Of course, presumably moral and ethical considerations would forbid such a genetic experiment, but this possibility does illustrate how similar human beings are to other primates. Even an animal as apparently distant from humans as our pet dog is still quite similar to us. We are both mammals, and the DNA sequence codes of dogs and humans have better than 90% agreement with each other. If we are so close genetically to non-human animals in all other aspects, it seems unlikely that evolution would make a sudden quantitative and qualitative jump when it comes to language ability. The more logical conclusion would be that evolution was heading toward the appearance of human-level linguistic abilities. And if we look hard enough, we will find a continuous series of stages that lead to our own form of language ability. These early language abilities will not appear full-blown, but the precursors should first make their appearance in the communication patterns of other animals, such as dogs. The logical expectation is that the language of dogs will be a lot simpler than the language of people, but that same logic suggests that there will be a language of dogs. If the logic of the situation suggests that other animals should have some simpler form of language, then why do researchers, such as Chomsky, suggest that the human species is so special in linguistic ability? Actually, they are continuing a long tradition which began with philosophers and early naturalists, who wanted to make the argument that human beings are unique and in a class by themselves. There is something in that line of reasoning that appeals to our ego. It makes us feel proud that we are so gifted, that all of nature is beneath us, and perhaps even that God has singled us out for some special blessing. Human beings obviously differ from animals in many ways. Humans, for example, are the only animals that have large, pendulous breasts, wear clothes, pierce body parts, such as ears, and insert ornaments into the holes, dye their hair, tattoo their bodies, paint their faces, use money, or cook their food. Such minor differences bring us no pride. Rather, it has always been in the mental realms, such as reasoning, morals, and language, that we wish to assert our uniqueness and our superiority. Probably the best-known version of this argument was given by René Descartes, who proposed that no animals other than humans had consciousness, real intelligence, or any sort of higher mental abilities. Non-human animals were simply furry machines, very cleverly built, which reacted to stimulation from the world in much the same way that a machine responds when you throw a switch. The church supported Descartes' conclusions, since if animals had true thinking ability, they might also have souls. If they had souls, then this would raise certain ethical issues about the treatment of animals, which the church did not want to deal with, such as the morality of killing animals for food, denying them free will, or forcing them into service for humans. For Descartes, to test whether an animal could think and had consciousness, you simply tested their language competence, specifically, their ability to creatively produce spoken human language. The idea that man was special was not universally believed, however. The Greek philosopher Aristotle, the scholar St. Thomas Aquinas, and the evolutionary biologist Charles Darwin all came to the conclusion that humans and animals differ only quantitatively in the degree to which their mental abilities express themselves, rather than qualitatively in the actual nature of those mental processes. This would, for instance, allow a less complex species to have a language that is not as complex as that of humans. Of course, whether animals have language or not depends upon how you define language. If you define language as any communication system or signaling system, then every living animal on this planet would probably have to be credited with language. Crickets and grasshoppers communicate their location and availability to potential mates with sounds made by rubbing the rasp-like edges of their hind legs together, while fireflies communicate a similar message by flashes of light. Should insects be credited with having language? The ethologist Carl von Frisch thought so, and he won the Nobel Prize for his work in translating what he called the language of the bee. The honeybee has evolved an extraordinary method of communication to assist in the survival of its hive. Specialized scouts search for food and return with the news when they have found a supply of nectar or pollen. They then inform the rest of the hive by means of a set of unique dancing movements. They circle the hive wall or floor in sort of a figure-eight pattern, waggling their abdomens as they dance. The specific patterns and speed of movements that they make, and the orientation and size of the patterns, convey information about the direction and the quality of the food they have found. Their movements also describe the distance to the food source, which might be several miles away. In bee colonies, there is even a special house-hunting scout, who appears to be uninterested in bringing back information about food supplies. This scout scours the area for a new location for another hive. If a colony finds itself with two queens, one is inevitably driven out. She gathers a band of loyal followers who will go with her to start the new community in the place found by the scout. The language of these scouts is so precise and accurate that the researcher observing the message was able to reach the new colony site before the bees themselves had arrived at their new home. Although this is remarkable behavior, and most scientists would grant that honeybees have a complex communication system, the vast majority of researchers would refer to this as a signaling system rather than a true language. There just seems to be too little flexibility in the content and too much simplicity in the structure of the system to make scientists truly comfortable with calling it language. Bees seem to talk of nothing except, "Where is the food?" and "Where shall we set up housekeeping?" No bee ever seems to say, "I'm feeling happy today. I like you. I find this job boring," or "I would like to grow up to be queen myself someday." What constitutes the minimum requirement for a true language is a difficult question, and it is something that we will ultimately have to address. However, there are some aspects of human language that might not be required in all other languages. For instance, most people tend to confuse language with speech. Obviously, for humans, speech is the most common form of expressing ideas via language. In terms of evolution, voices are a rather late development. To produce spoken words requires a voice box, technically called the larynx. If you place your fingertips on your throat and speak or hum, you can feel the vibrations that are produced as air passes through the larynx and produces sounds. The larynx appears in higher land animals, including mammals and some reptiles and amphibians, as part of the windpipe that carries air to the lungs. Although a summer evening in the country can be filled with insect noises, no insect has a voice box, nor does any other invertebrate, that is, any animal without a backbone. Fish do not have a larynx either, since fish breathe using gills to extract oxygen rather than lungs. In order to understand how people are special in their ability to speak, we need to spend a couple of paragraphs on a bit of physiology. The larynx has several segments of firm, elastic cartilage held together by muscle and ligaments. It extends from the throat, pharynx, above to the windpipe, trachea, below. Because the mouth can be used both to take in food and to breathe, you need a special apparatus to separate these functions. This is the epiglottis, which is much like a box lid that swings over the opening between the throat and the voice box. When an animal swallows, the larynx is raised to press against the epiglottis and root of the tongue, closing off the windpipe so that food can be directed to the stomach and will not cause choking by getting into the airway. Voice sounds are produced when air interacts with the vocal cords. These are two thin bands or folds of membrane lying across the upper section of the larynx in a V shape. The tension on these folds is controlled by muscles. When you breathe normally, your vocal muscles are slack, which allows air to pass silently in and out of a wide slit. When the muscles are tighter, the vocal cords begin to vibrate. The tighter the vocal muscles contract the vocal cords, the higher the pitch or tone of the sound produced. This is much like what happens with a toy balloon. If you blow it up and release the pressure on the opening, the air rushes out silently. Slightly stretching the rubber at the opening to make a narrow slit causes the outward rushing to make sounds, which will vary in pitch as you vary the tension. The movements of the tongue and the lips will further modify the nature of the sounds, shaping, molding, and clipping them into new patterns. The reason that it is important to know about the voice box is because humans and dogs are built differently, and this limits the sounds that dogs can make in comparison to people. In dogs, there is only a slight bend in the airway as we go from the mouth to the windpipe. In human beings, because we stand vertically, there is a 90-degree bend in the airway. This leaves room for the larynx to lengthen and for there to be additional sound-making accessories, such as two resonating cavities instead of the dog's one. In addition, humans have room for a larger, rounder tongue in comparison to the shorter, flat tongue of dogs. Thus, a dog simply does not have the vocal apparatus and control to voluntarily and selectively produce various different speech sounds, as the A in bay, the I in bit, or the U in usual. Another difference between dogs and humans is that, as hunters that often track their prey by its scent trail, canines have adapted their airways to make it easy to smell and breathe while they are running. This involves having the epiglottis locked into a closed position most of the time. It still allows canines to bark, yap, or howl while they are moving. In humans, This lid-like flap is open most of the time when we are talking. Don't let your dog develop an inferiority complex because of its limited ability to make certain sounds. This is a very modern evolutionary development. It seems that similar difficulties were experienced by some of our fairly recent human ancestors, such as Neanderthal man. The evidence is that Neanderthals probably did not have speech, or only had limited speech abilities. Soft tissue such as a larynx doesn't survive well, so we have no fossilized vocal tracts from primitive humanoids. However, the psychologist Philip Lieberman has demonstrated that if you try to insert a modern human vocal tract directly into the skeleton of a Neanderthal, it simply doesn't fit. The modern larynx ends up in a weird and unlikely position inside the Neanderthal's chest. Obviously, this is an impossible placement. We are left with the conclusion that Neanderthals probably lacked the more refined apparatus necessary to make complex speech sounds. There is another aspect of human evolution which gives people an advantage over dogs in terms of speech production. Because humans walk upright, our hands are free to manipulate things so that we hunt and protect ourselves using weapons held in our hands. This means that we don't need a strong muzzle full of teeth to do these jobs. We can have shorter snouts and muzzles, and can allow our lips more flexibility to shape sounds. Our more flexible faces also give us the apparatus to produce a broader range of voice sounds than is possible for dogs. Actually, evolutionary considerations such as these have led to a marvelously speculative theory that dogs may be responsible for the development of human spoken language. To follow this argument, we need to point out that there is some new evidence based upon DNA analyses which suggests that dogs may have been domesticated by humans for far longer than scientists had previously imagined. It is possible that dogs may have been domesticated as long as 100,000 years ago. Pushing back the origins of the domestic dog into that distant past has allowed a new wave of thinking about how dogs and humans co-evolved. It is well established that the primitive humans who survived to become our forefathers formed an early relationship with dogs. Compare our success to that of the Neanderthals, who never got along with dogs, and who ultimately died out. Some evolutionary theorists have suggested that the survival of our ancestors had to do with the fact that our cooperative partnership with dogs made us more efficient hunters than Neanderthals. With the dogs' more acute sensory systems, finding game was easier. Dogs' exquisite sense of smell, combined with the adaptation of their airways to allow them to continue following a scent, even while running, made them proficient trackers. Finding game is clearly one of the most important tasks facing a hunting society. Here is where the serious speculation begins. These theorists suggest that since these early humans now had dogs to do the tracking, they no longer needed the facial structures that would allow them to detect faint scents. This, then, allowed our early ancestors to evolve more flexible facial features, which were capable of shaping more complex sounds. In other words, our prehistoric association with dogs, who would do the smelling for us, gave us the ability to create speech. The rival Neanderthal race, however, never formed a compact with dogs. This meant that they were left with less flexible facial features, since they still needed their better scenting abilities. Less flexibility means more limited voice control, which in turn would make speech far more difficult. Once early man had the ability to shape speech sounds, this permitted the development of spoken language. As we have already heard, language brings with it many advantages. It can help to organize a group, It can allow the passing on of knowledge and information, and it can provide us with a number of other survival advantages. Think of it. If this theory is correct, then it may well be the case that human speech owes its very existence to our association with dogs. Although dogs do not have speech, this does not necessarily mean that they don't have language. We know that many deaf people use signs rather than sounds as their form of language. Similarly, although evolution has denied the dog the facial flexibility, the voice box, and the degree of voluntary control needed to create human speech sounds, it is still possible that dogs can use other means to communicate. Perhaps these other forms of canine communication may have the richness and complexity needed to create a language. 3. A dog is listening. There is one thing that people tend to forget when considering how individuals use language. Linguistic ability actually involves two important components. The first is the ability to understand language. This is really the most basic requirement. Second, and more complex, is the ability to produce language. It is possible to comprehend language, but not to produce it. This is the case for individuals who are born mute or lose their ability to produce voice sounds through some form of accident or illness. Such people may understand what is being said, but they cannot produce the sounds which make up the language they are interpreting. We call their skills receptive language ability, as opposed to productive language ability, which includes not only the ability to comprehend a language, but also to produce it so that someone else can interpret it. The earliest stages of human language development involve the development of receptive language. By the time it is 13 months old, a human baby will typically understand nearly 100 words. However, its productive language is virtually non-existent at this age. At 13 months, most children will be producing one or two meaningful language sounds, while the brightest children may be producing 5 or 6 words. Clearly, young children develop an understanding of language before they can speak. The fact that language reception is easier to learn than language production was recognized by the U.S. Space Agency, NASA, when it started the first multinational cooperative space missions. When American and Russian astronauts were first brought together to work in space, each was required to speak their own native language. Thus, American astronauts spoke only English, while Russian astronauts spoke only Russian. Each astronaut then only had to be able to understand, but not to produce, the other tongue. This made communication much easier and more accurate, since receptive language ability can reach high levels of efficiency in a much shorter time. I have noticed this same pattern in my own language experience. I can interpret English, Russian, German, Spanish, French and Italian enough to be able to understand movies in these languages without subtitles, or to follow conversations with reasonable ability. On the other hand, I believe that I speak English fluently, Spanish moderately well, German at a lower level, French with minimally understandable competence. My Russian and Italian productive language make me sound like a 2 or 3-year-old as far as linguistic fluency is concerned. Thus, like all human infants, my receptive language is many times better than my productive language. Dogs certainly have the sound discrimination ability to develop receptive language. They can actually pick up quite subtle nuances in human word pronunciations. One example of this involves the ethologist Victor Saris. He had developed a fondness for the sound of his own name. And for this reason, he gave his 3 dogs names that rhymed with Saris, calling them Paris, Harris, and Aris. While one might have expected that this would cause confusion, it did not. Each dog responded to its own name accurately, and none seemed to bear a grudge toward their master over his odd naming practices. One must not underestimate the receptive language ability of dogs. The fact that they are not able to produce human sounds to communicate with us doesn't mean that they do not comprehend human words. A dog can prove that it comprehends when it responds to spoken words appropriately. The dog can obey a spoken command, or produce an intelligent or appropriate behavior in response to our spoken message. Everyone who has ever lived with a dog knows that they quickly learn to respond to a number of human words. As an example, let me give you a mini dictionary of my own three dogs' working vocabularies. This should provide some sense of the scope of a typical dog's receptive language ability, though it is certainly not the upper limit of what they are capable of learning. Some of the words and phrasings my dogs learn are quite idiosyncratic to me, reflecting my lifestyle and the way that I interact with my dogs. Some of the words may also not be responded to by all three of my dogs, since that depends upon their age and present level of training. It is also true that my partial list includes only words that I deliberately use to get a response, rather than other words that the dogs may understand but aren't formally required to respond to. Each word in this sampling is presented along with the actions which demonstrate the dog's comprehension. Away. The dog responds to this command by moving back from whatever it was investigating or attending to. Back. I use this only in the car. In response, the dog moves from the front to the back seat area. Bad dog. This is a term of displeasure. The dogs recognize the implicit anger and usually respond by submissively cringing and sometimes by leaving the room. Be close. I use this phrase when walking my dogs. In reply, a dog that has been lagging too far back will move up to a position closer to me. Be quick. This is taught during housebreaking. Upon hearing it, the dog will start searching for a place to eliminate, even if this is only a token leg lift to please me. By me. This is a multi-purpose command used in daily activities to get a free-ranging dog to return to a position close by my left side. Collar off. This useful expression causes the dog to respond by lowering its head to allow its collar to be slipped over and off more easily. Collar on. Obviously, this is the companion phrase. In answer, the dog lifts its head, pointing its muzzle up to allow the collar to be slipped on with less effort. Come. The basic recall command. Den. One of many go-to-someplace commands. In this case, it directs the dogs to go to my office at home to wait for me. Do you want to play? This phrase causes the dog to circle, bark, and emit play bows in preparation for some fun and exercise. Down. This causes the dog to lie down immediately, without changing locations. Downstairs. When it hears this, the dog responds by going down a set of stairs in front of it. Drop it. This defensive expression is taught to my dogs as puppies, when they are most apt to pick things up in their mouths that might be harmful to them. In response, the dog spits out whatever it has in its mouth onto the ground. Excuse me. A useful phrase that I use when one of my dogs is blocking my path of movement. In reply, the dog gets up and stands aside to allow me to pass. Find glove. A command that is part of formal dog obedience competition training. In response, the dog searches back across the ring to retrieve a glove that has been dropped earlier. Find it. Another competition command. It tells the dog to find the one item with my scent which has been placed among a group of other items carrying the ring steward's scent. Front. The obedience version of the more casual recall command, come. When I tell the dog to come, simply arriving near me is all that is required. When I tell the dog front, however, he is supposed to return and then sit squarely in front of me until I tell him what to do next. Give. This word is used when I want to take something out of my dog's mouth. In response, the dog releases the pressure on any item it is holding in its mouth so that I can remove it easily. Give me a kiss. In answer to this, the dog licks my face. Give me a paw. When it hears this, the dog will lift the paw nearest my hand to have nails clipped or paws toweled dry. Go back. This command is always given with a hand signal to indicate direction. When it is given, the dog moves away from me in a straight line along the direction indicated until I tell him to stop. Good dog. The general-purpose term of praise that usually causes tail wagging in pleasure. It is interchangeable with good boy for my all-male dog collection. Heel. The traditional command to get a dog to walk under control by my left side. Hugs. This is a silly command, but I like it. I use it to get my dogs to jump up in front of me, with their legs on my thighs, allowing me to pet them without bending. In. The dog responds to this command by going through an open door or gate in the direction indicated by my hand motion. Jump. I use this word to get a dog to leap over some object or obstruction I'm pointing to. Kennel. In response to this command, the dog goes into its kennel. Lead on. Another of those utilitarian phrases that make life with the dog easier. In answer to lead on, the dog lifts its head to provide access to collar ring. Lead off produces the same response. Let's go. Really, the casual form of the heel command, where the dog's only requirement is to stay reasonably close to me as I walk. The dog can be a short distance in front or back of me and doesn't have to sit when I stop. Loose. A play command that tells the dog it is free to chase an object I have thrown. No. This command is always given in a loud, sharp tone of voice. The intent is to have the dog freeze and stop all ongoing activities. To get that freezing response, the first few times that I use this command with a new puppy, I accompany it with a loud, sharp sound. Banging a pot against a counter works well. Slapping a wall or a table. Stamping one's foot on a wooden floor. Even throwing a book down flat on the floor will also work. This command is extremely useful to keep your dog out of trouble. A shout of no can freeze a dog who is approaching a frightened child or a dangerous situation. Once he has stopped his approach, the command, by me, brings him to my side, where I can control him with my hands and supervise any subsequent events. Open your mouth. I use this when I'm cleaning my dog's teeth. Out. A limited use command, which simply tells the dog to leave its kennel or whatever other enclosure it is in, such as my car. Pick up your toys. A handy housekeeping phrase that causes the dog to search the room for dog toys and bring them to me. Playtime. This word is a release, which indicates that an exercise is finished, or that the requirements imposed by the last command have now terminated. The word causes the dog to break from position and come for praise. In other circumstances, the dog may dance about a bit, or explore the room, or greet nearby people or other dogs. In the past, with other dogs, I used the word okay as my release, since it seemed so natural. Unfortunately, okay is a common phrase in the language, and people may often say it with great enthusiasm, so that my dogs thought that other people were giving them their release. Once, at a dog show, someone yelled, "Okay!" in joy when their dog won best of breed in the confirmation competition. Unfortunately, I was in the middle of an obedience trial in the next ring. My cairn terrier, Flint, was supposedly in a down and stay position for 5 minutes, with me out of sight with the other competitors. The sound of his release command so close was just what he was waiting for, so he popped up happily and began trying to introduce himself to the other dogs, who were still dutifully doing their exercise. Starting the very next day, I dropped okay as my release word and substituted playtime. At least this word is used with much lower frequency in general conversations, and virtually never in the dog obedience ring. Quiet. This stops a dog's barking, at least for the moment. Relax. This slows my dog down to relieve tugging on the leash when we're walking. Roll over. Well, everybody has to teach the dog some tricks to keep their children or grandchildren happy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.